Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Chef Joey Altman, your moderator for the program. Tonight's program is part of the Commonwealth Club's Food Lit series, underwritten by the Bernard Osher Foundation. Our guest today is a multiple award-winning chef who has dramatically transformed the way many Americans perceive Mexican food. Through his restaurants, cookbooks, and television series, Chef Rick Bayless has shown that Mexican cuisine can be the Rosetta Stone of Mexican history and its diverse cultures. But don't let the highfalutin sounding nature of his expertise fool you for a second. Rick Bayless is all about discovering big, bold flavors, sharing his passion for cooking for family, friends, and soon-to-be friends, and then washing it all down with a healthy dose of tequila. In other words, this master top chef, with his advanced degrees in anthropological linguistics, is also a really fun guy. In addition to his hedonistic culinary endeavors, his progressive entrepreneurial ethics and his commitment to helping others is quite laudable. Whether it's empowering his employees as partners in expanding his food businesses, or working with hunger-fighting organizations such as Share Our Strength, or his pursuit to ensure sustainability of our food sources by working with groups such as Chefs Collaborative and his own Frontera Farmers Foundation, Chef Bayless has had seemingly limitless energy and a desire to use his rising tide to raise all boats. Please help me welcome Chef Rick Bayless to the Commonwealth.
Thank you.
Okay, well, welcome.
Thank you. After an introduction like that, I'm not sure where we can go. It's either really downhill or really uphill, or the other.
Well, first of all, I just want to tell you how much I enjoyed reading your new book.
Okay.
It's fantastic. It really, you have been studying and learning about Mexican food and its culture, and I just simply married into it. And your book is really helped me impress my in-laws quite a bit, because we party a lot, and I have broken out some of your recipes, and they're just super thrilled with my catching on quick.
Cool.
By the way, that also, I don't know how good this will work for radio, but I did bring something for you here. I'm going to open up my little red satchel that I got in San Miguel de Allende.
I'm glad you're all themed out here.
Oh, yeah. And I brought some of my favorite tortilla chips here. This is from a local producer. These are organic, Casa Sanchez. I think
Casa
you'll like
Sanchez.
Them quite a bit.
I hope you made that fresh today.
About an hour ago. That's okay. Why I was a little late getting here.
Okay. Well, we got a little...
Well, hold on. Wait for the garnish.
Thank you. Oh, he got Brit bacon. You know, he's pulling out all the
stuff.
Yeah.
This is from page 26. Mm-hmm. This is the guacamole with bacon. I have made guacamole for many, many years, and I thought I took it up with grilled corn. But when I saw bacon guacamole, I was like, damn him.
It's an easy shot.
It really is, mm-hmm. But it's
bacon
a beautiful...
Bacon makes practically anything better.
It sure does make this guacamole.
Here,
I'm going to. Thank you very much.
I like the little bacon garnish there. That's such a nice thing, especially in a plastic, we call them deli containers here.
Well, I did bring my Mexican bowl, but...
Okay. But we're just going to be informal here.
Right.
Okay.
And I noticed that...
No.
I brought an avocado here.
Because
in your book, there's many recipes with avocados, and I noticed that
you promote avocados quite a bit, and I'm really proud of our California avocados, but I wanted you to have an opportunity to tell people about picking an avocado, because so many people I know buy an avocado, they're $3.50 at the grocery store, they seem to get more and more expensive every year. But when they get home, they cut it open, and sometimes it's not beautiful inside.
Ooh. Well, we could talk for hours about avocados.
So why don't you, your quick tip.
The thing about avocados that everybody has to understand is that they don't ripen on the tree. So if you ever find anybody that says they've got tree-ripened avocados, just laugh in their face. It's one of the few fruits in the world, and it is botanically a fruit, that will stay hard on the tree when it falls off naturally, falls off, or is picked off and kept at room temperature, it will immediately start to ripen. Or you can cool it down and it'll put it into a sort of state of suspended animation. Then if you want it to go to ripeness, you bring it up to room temperature again. And one of the problems, and what you were alluding to, and sometimes our lack of enthusiasm about what we bring home from the grocery store, is that you can force ripen an avocado. And in lesser hands, that often happens, where they'll put it into a room that's too warm, like 85 degrees rather than 70 degrees. Sometimes they will pump that room full of ethylene gas, ethylene gas is something that an avocado will naturally emit as it goes through the ripening stage. So if you just pump a whole bunch more in there, you will find it where it will ripen a lot faster. Unfortunately, if you put it in a hot room and pump in a lot of ethylene gas, it will ripen very unevenly. Then if you chill it down to hold it in a good state for a longer period, it'll brown on the inside, and you will get home and you will have an unevenly ripened avocado that's brown. So it needs to be ripened right. And actually, the ripening process in avocados is as important as the growing process. So we all have to keep that part of it in mind. So always buy them at a place that's going to turn over a lot of avocados. That's why I always tell people, go to the Mexican grocery store. They're usually cheaper and they're more carefully ripened there, because they're going through so many, and they'll always have ones that are ripe. And if you're gonna make guacamole and the avocado isn't ripe enough, you don't get that creamy, beautiful stuff that you're looking for, but you get something that's kind of chunky and, you know, it won't have that nice creaminess to it. And the bulbous end is the part that will ripen the last. So you need to be able to press like that, have a little bit of give.
I call it the Charmin squeeze.
It's a Charmin squeeze. It definitely is a Charmin squeeze right on that end of it, not up here, because this will ripen first. Then if it's feeling like that, you know that if it's Haas avocado, which is what these are, the ones that we see most of the time, it will hold in your refrigerator for about 3 days or so. If you put it in the warmest section of your refrigerator, and then you can cut it open and make your guacamole out of it.
Now, I also will just add one thing, that the avocado sometimes can feel ripe, and then you get home and it's actually more ripe or browning, and that's not great for guacamole sometimes. So I found that the avocado has sort of like a window into its soul, and it's right here where it attaches to the stem, and you can peel that off. And if it's nice and green right there, right, it'll be nice and green inside. If it's browning, you just put that back there, and you just pick up another one. But just move. Don't make sure the produce guy isn't eyeing you, and don't shop at the same place at the same time often. Okay.
Well, and without that little button in there, the avocado, you should never buy that avocado, because it opens up the opportunity for air to get in there, and air is what browns the avocado flesh. So you always want to have that on there.
Well, thank you very much for sharing that.
Actually, that was the most useful thing that you'll learn all day. The rest of it is just going to be blather after that.
Okay, well, we'll see about that. Okay, so I know it's on everybody's mind here. They are big fans of yours, and many of them have been watching you on PBS or reading your books, going to your restaurants, but there are definitely a few people here who may have discovered you recently on Bravo's Top Chef. We in the Bay Area, I think, were at a little bit of a disadvantage, because we had somebody who blurbed the winner before the series even, I think, got underway. It was like two episodes into it, and they posted, and then got taken away. But we already knew, but we still watched because it was just so much fun to watch.
That's good.
So tell us about your experience on Bravo's Top Chef, and what made you sort of rise above, do you think?
Well, first of all, I was totally foolish to just go out and do that. It was really hard. And about halfway through the first quickfire challenge, I realized I had a lot to lose. And all of the chefs that had said that they were going to go on and do that had a lot to lose. If you're one of the young bucks that's coming up through the regular Top Chef, nobody knows who you are. You have no reputation. You're trying to get your name out there and show people that you know what you're doing. On Top Chef Masters, of course, everyone already came with a reputation and a lot of years of experience.
Right.
So you get in the middle of it and you realize there's so many ways you could look like a fool on this show. We got the first challenge that we did, for me, the first quickfire, was to cook a dish that was all one color. Okay, so you had to pull knives, and I got green, which I thought was kind of easy. You know, it was, I cook a lot of green food, so I thought this would be a kind of easy task to
do. Slam dunk.
But it was 30 minutes, and you had to make a dish, and you had to present it to food stylists and food photographers. They were going to be the judges on that particular challenge. So there we were, cooking away, and I looked up at the clock, and it said 19. And this is a 30-minute challenge. It said 19. And I screamed at one of the producers, "Is that 19 minutes left?" And she said, "No, we're 19 minutes into it." And I thought, oh, no, there's no way I can get out of this thing because I didn't have my sauce simmering yet on the stove. So I had all the ingredients in this high-speed blender, Vitamix blender, and all of a sudden it went into my head that I'm one of those geeks that reads all the little manuals that come with the appliances, and if they send a video, even better, I'll watch it. I'm one of those people that'll actually watch the video that comes. So I'd watched this video that came with the Vitamix blender, and somebody was making a soup in the Vitamix blender because it's so high-powered and the blades go so fast, you can actually bring it up to a simmer in the Vitamix blender. So I thought, this is the only way I'm going to get out of this thing. So I did I left it going. It was a horrible noise in the kitchen, but I left it going until it was ready to plate, and I poured my hot sauce out because it got all hot in there. Of course, it wasn't simmered for very long, but I got it all out there, and I realized that at that moment, that this competition required something that had nothing really that much to do with cooking. It had to do with playing this game, and how could you approach doing the challenge that they gave you in this tiny little bit of time. And so you had to be really creative. So it was all about thinking outside a box, which of course, as chefs, we have to do from time to time. Being a chef of a restaurant is very much like being on stage for live performance. Things go wrong all the time, but the audience never should know that anything has gone wrong. You cover it over, you change things, you come up with something on the spot just like that. Well, that's when I realized that I do that sort of thing all the time, and I like doing it. And I grew up in catering, and catering, as anybody that's ever done it,
it's Latin for things will hit the fan.
They will. It certainly is. And you just have to be ready to punt at any moment because something will just cross your path and you go, okay, well, we'll just change it all and we'll do it this way. So that's what I think got me through Top Chef Masters, is that I had a really strong background in catering. So I was used to working on the spot, and I liked playing the game. Now, there are some chefs that went on to that show that are really amazing chefs. They just didn't know how to play the game part of it. And when I realized that that was the biggest thing, of course you had to be a good chef. You had to have techniques that you could implore. And the most critical thing, since people were going to eat the food, it actually had to taste good. And they were going to judge you on the taste. And I have to say, so many chefs fell down because they did everything but taste their food, because they were so worried about getting it on the plate that they didn't ever stop to taste it. And I am so dedicated to flavor. In our restaurants, we have this sort of ritual tasting that we go through 2 times a day. And the line cook sets up their station where they're going to make the dishes that they're responsible for. So that cook has to taste everything in their station. Then a sous chef comes by and tastes everything in the station. And then the chef de cuisine or I will come by and taste everything in their station. And we do this thing twice a day because we're so dedicated to flavor. A lot of chefs don't do that kind of thing. They're looking for, sometimes their food is simple enough that it just requires some salt or whatever, and ours is really complex in all of its flavors. So it's all about the delicate balance of those flavors that you've brought together. But here we were in Top Chef Masters, and I saw so many of the chefs not tasting their food. And they made beautiful plates, but they didn't come to the final step, which was to give it that beautiful flavor that they were supposedly well known for.
Now, there were a lot of chefs who had some sort of bumps in the road along the way there. Did any of the other cooks want to fight with you like they did Michael Chiarello?
I was waiting for that. I wanted to see if that would happen. But, you know, Michael is a friend of mine, and I've always really enjoyed working with him. But the one thing about Michael that you probably know and many people here discovered watching that show is that he doesn't really like young cooks to challenge him. So
anybody for that matter. I mean, I know Michael. He's a good friend. I have utmost respect for him. But he's got his way or the highway.
He's sort of his way or the highway. But that young chef that, I forget his name now, he challenged him. And that was like sparks. It was going on right next to me. And I'm like, ooh, I think I'm crawling under the table now. I really thought they were going to go to blows.
But did you realize at that moment, okay, this is a TV moment?
It was a total TV moment. And as you all saw, like, they replayed that, 1,000 times or so during that thing, because it was such a perfect TV moment.
Right. Now, you also, talking about game shows, you went on Dancing with Celebrities of Chicago and won that.
I'm a glutton for punishment.
Is there a game show you won't do?
No, I thought they were. Now I'm into it. Now bring them on. No, it was really.
Hello, wait, don't tell me. I want to play.
I already did that one.
You did that. Oh.
No, it was really fun. I realized that I never was into sort of playing games like that at all until after. Actually, I did the dancing thing first, and that really hooked me on those kinds of things, and I realized that I had never danced ballroom before, and I thought, wouldn't this be an interesting thing to sort of try my hand at? And I fell so in love with ballroom that I still dance ballroom now once a week, and I competed only one time they would let me compete because then I won, but then I've gone back to that same thing and I've performed, I don't know, half dozen more times because I loved it.
And what's your favorite dance?
Cha-cha.
Cha-cha.
I'm really into cha-cha. Cha-cha or salsa, either way. Salsa is sort of natural. If I'd said that, you all would have moaned, but cha-cha is really my thing.
Very good. Okay, moving on. It seems like it's a great time to be a chef right now. The quality of ingredients, the availability of great ingredients, the availability and quantity of cooks who are enthusiastic and sometimes really talented, and also a dining public that seems insatiable for great food. And it seems like it's a great time for chefs who want to execute their vision. How do you see the culinary landscape from your perspective?
It's very different than it was 23 years ago when we opened Frontera. I was glad that you brought in the dining public, because it's the chefs can go do whatever we want, but unless we have the support and the growing sophistication on the part of our dining public, then we're sort of left out in the left field there. Nobody will really support us because they don't understand what we're doing. And I started off at that time in the history of dining in the United States when there were we had sort of come to this new realization that something was missing. We had gone through the era of, you know, sort of pre-World War II, where the food was much more regional. People cooked at home all the time. Lots of people had gardens. They made simple food, but they canned, they preserved, they did all this different stuff. World War II came, and everything changed, and we started shipping food around. Everybody wanted a big deep freeze so that they could just pack it full of all kinds of stuff that they bought already frozen. Or I was a kid of the 50s, and it was so cool, we thought, to have those TV dinners on those little foil trays that we would once a week stick into the oven, turn the TV on, and then we would eat these things out. You know, it was everything on one thing, including the dessert, and we would sit in front of the TV eating out of foil. Now, it just like, it goes against everything I stand for now, but that we thought as a kid.
It was a novelty, and it was awesome.
It was so
awesome. Peeling back and going, I wonder what my dessert is.
Yes, exactly.
Apple pie, bonus.
And we got to go to the grocery store sometime with my mom, and we would choose which TV dinner we wanted to have and all that sort of thing. So it was a big treat, But then all of a sudden that gave way from our once a week during the summer when we got to visit McDonald's to McDonald's every day, and then we lost our way in this country. And it wasn't really until the 70s there was a bit of a backlash, and then into the 80s we were all starting to turn back and say, we've really gone the wrong way with food in the United States, and now we need to reclaim that. But we had lost a generation or two of people who didn't understand what good food was. They had never tasted a lot of good food. They didn't know how to make good food. And I think that it's taking us now well into the 21st century to have established a dining public, an eating public, if you want to say that, that understands what really good food is. And I tell you, it's a real pleasure now to be able to put together a menu in our restaurant, put it out in front of our guests, and have them go, this is fabulous. You know, you're taking us down that path, the next step and the next step and the next step. And we feel like that we are now not just offering good fresh food, but good fresh food that has a real perspective to it. It might be the perspective, in our case, of one village in Oaxaca. It might be the perspective of the coast of Veracruz, or maybe the highlands of Veracruz. And now we can talk to our customers about those things, and they have enough experience with the world of regional foods that they can go down that path with us, and they can taste it, and they can understand it. And it's not just novel anymore, but it's enriching. It's like, oh yeah, this is not just like we're going to eat at the hot new restaurant, but we're going to eat at a restaurant that is the full package. And that's what we try to offer. And we have just kept taking those steps as our guests will take them with us.
Do you find that it's somewhat ironic that as the level of consciousness of what you're speaking about, of quality and the history of good food and what real food is about, is growing exponentially in this country, that as at the same time, there's also this epidemic of childhood obesity and fast food and junk food is also growing in its consumption at the same time?
Very much so. And we are going down dual paths, and I think we all know that. And all I can say is that as people who are aware of food and good food and healthy food, and to me that just means fresh food, because I think all food that is natural is healthy and has a really important place in our diet. But as a group of people that's aware of that, we need to sort of do what we can to bring the system into balance, meaning that, you know, we have to step away, as we are, from calling ketchup a vegetable for the school kids. And we also have to support the people that are like the two of us, that are helping to put good food in its entirety, in its fullness, in the full understanding of that, out in front of the public, because we need to do work on both sides at one time. And I know that there is very easy for people to look at what I do in my restaurants and say it's elitist food because it's made with really carefully raised ingredients that are carefully crafted, and we charge the right price for that kind of thing. And so people go, oh yeah, well, it's just food for the well-to-do. And I say, but without that, we have no touchstones. We have nothing that we can sort of say is what is the benchmark that we can bring everybody else to. And we all know, I think, that the more really good food that's out there, the more competition there is for getting that food to people at a more reasonable price. And so I feel like that we have to work on both sides of the good food equation at one time. We have to work to get good food in the hands of the people that are perhaps relying just on junk food, just cheap food. We have to work really hard to get good food to those people at the same time that we're exploring what the world of food really has to offer for us, because that's where we're going to find a lot of good stuff that's going to go the other direction as well. So I'm a firm believer in following both of those paths.
Now, I know the Obamas are big fans of yours. They've eaten in your restaurants. You've cooked in their kitchen.
Their home kitchen.
Their home kitchen. Whipped up a little something, something for them. And I know Michelle Obama is very interested in trying to tackle the nation's issues with childhood obesity and nutrition. Has she ever talked to you about it? And have you ever given her any, if you had like a mandate of what we should be doing as far as food goes, share that with her? Or?
Well, we really haven't talked about it sort of personally, though. We've been invited to be part of different things, the different initiatives that they've worked on. The one thing that I haven't had the opportunity to say to her that I really want to at some point.
So Michelle, if you're listening out
yes,
there.
Yes, Michelle, please take note. Get out a pencil and paper. they have such a great opportunity with two school-age kids to be to offer to the country a good role model for what can be done. And I think that every week they need to put out recipes of what they're eating, because they're a beautiful family. We all know that. President Obama, Mrs. Obama, just as the kind of people everyone wants to emulate because they look so regal and beautiful and they're so fit. And then you've got those two beautiful children. There's not a person in this country that wouldn't want to eat like the Obamas. And I feel like that they're missing an opportunity by not getting the recipes out there for doing that kind of thing. So when I was hanging out in the White House kitchen a couple of months ago, I had the opportunity to talk with the kitchen staff about all of that. And as you realize, walking into the White House, nothing is easy, nothing is simple. And to do something like recipes from the White House comes cloaked in all kinds of struggles with people saying, no, but the beef contingent wants this, the pork contingent wants that, you know, the people that are doing eggs are lobbying for something else, and you didn't use such and such in the recipe, or you used too specific of an ingredient, and now you've made these people over here mad and all that, that they decided not to really do very much with that. And as you realize when you're hanging out in the kitchen, that nobody mentions ever what that family eats, because it can create too much conflict for them on other things that they're doing. And I was thinking, wow, that it seems like it's such a missed opportunity for us. I'm sorry to hear that it's that fraught with difficulty, because it could be so powerful for them to say what they're eating and have simple, good recipes out there that everyone can follow. This doesn't have to be expensive food. They have simple tastes and they like really simple things. We could do that kind of stuff. And Chris Comerford, the chef of the White House, is just an amazing human being. She's a great cook. She has a family of her own that she cooks for all the time. She knows how to cater to those kids in a way that she can give them good, fresh, healthy food that they're just going to love. And I would just love to see from the White House something really substantive in terms of recipes that we can all follow.
Well, we'll just have to make one up and just say that they eat that.
And which contingent would it satisfy?
In one of your earlier books, you have I think it was a Mexico one plate at a time. You have an exercise, a six-step regimen, exercise regimen for re-engaging us with good, healthy food. I'll just read through them quickly, and then you can expand on it if you'd like to. The first one is cook with minimally processed foods, grow something, shop at a farmer's market, plan occasional celebration meals around seasonal foods, schedule at least one meal a week with people you care about, and then last, regularly prepare ethnic dishes, support restaurants that offer honest, fresh ethnic food, and cultivate friends who can share their ethnic traditions. Well, I can be Joey, your Jewish friend, and I can come over to your house and make matzo ball soup for you. So tell me what went into putting that list together and what What's important about it?
It's a very simple list that I think rings true to anybody that hears it. It's very, very basic things. I think that, as I just recently said here, that if you work with basic fresh food, it's all good. You don't have to be thinking too much about, we shouldn't be eating this, we shouldn't be eating that, or we should be eating this or that. It's all good. And it's all good in moderation. And if you have a sort of variety of foods in your diet, then you really don't have to be thinking too much about what you're eating, because it's all gonna nourish you in the right kind of way. What you'll notice that list does is it goes from the ingredients that we're talking about to the sharing of food with other people. And the one of those topics that I would like to sort of focus on the most is to prepare a meal around a special food. And that sort of goes into Fiesta at Rick's, because it's a book about sharing food with people that you care about, that you want to spend some time with. And I just remember so often growing up with a family that had gardens, that we would all have these meals that were centered around something in the garden becoming ripe or available to us. And so we would have the one meal that was nothing but corn on the cob. That's all you got for the meal, was just corn on the cob. And you could have as much corn on the cob as you wanted, but that was the meal, because that was the first picking of the corn. And it was a celebration of something that put you in a place. It put you in a time, and it put you there with people that had invested so much of themselves into the cultivation of that beautiful ingredient. And it was celebrated as its own thing. We did the exact same thing with the first tomatoes that came in. We did the same thing with peaches. We would have a whole meal around peach cobbler. Okay, so where that was what you got for dinner was peach cobbler. Now, it sounds kind of crazy, and people say, but it's not a balanced diet. No,
my kids would eat that every night if I made peach cobbler for dinner.
That was the thing, though. It only happened once a year, where you sat down and you celebrated this moment in time, this place on the earth that's given you this stuff, and with the people who had sort of cultivated along and created that special thing for you. And it's that kind of full engagement that makes you look at your food in a very different way. And I've said this for a really long time, that it's extremely important for us to go to farmers markets and look in the eyes of people who have grown or cultivated whatever it is that they're selling. Because when you have that kind of relationship with the people that are giving you your nourishment, you start to think about the stuff as being imbued with something very special, something beyond just the fact that it tastes good or that it looks pretty. But it's something that's got energy from one person to another. Now, I know that sounds sort of esoteric and New Agey and all that, but it's really true. And I have to say that it happened early on in our restaurant in a very dramatic way. When we opened Frontera in 1987, we didn't have a farmer's market in the city of Chicago. There was no farmer's market. So we're talking about 23 years ago that we started with nothing. Now we've got farmer's markets all over Chicago, because there is a clamor for good food from farmers. And people know that it's satisfying in a way that the grocery store stuff is not satisfying to them. We tried this farmer, little farmer, to come to us, and they went out of business, and another one, and they went out of business. And it was really hard, because we live in a climate where people had forgotten how to grow things 12 months a year. And these boutique farmers were sort of, you know, leftover hippies, and they were just trying to do their own little thing, but they didn't know the craft of farming. And so we saw these boutique farms go in and out of business at a great rate for about 3 or 4 years. And finally, we hooked up with this old couple. In retirement, they had gone back to the farm that he was raised on, and they had carved out a chunk of it. It was a typical corn and soybean farm from the Midwest, and they had carved out a chunk of it. They had let it lie fallow for 3 years. They had gone for organic certification for this thing, and they were crafting food in a way that none of the other farmers knew how to do, because they were old enough to have known what it was like to grow food 12 months a year in the Chicago area back in the 20s. Okay, so these were old people, and they were doing all this great cultivation for them, and we were like buying almost everything that they were producing. And one day, they came to deliver some stuff to the restaurant, and the wife of the couple started taking crates of lettuce off the back of their truck. And one of the prep cooks grabbed a crate of lettuce and tossed it over, and it landed where he wanted it to land, right by the walk-in door. And she grabbed him by the nape of the neck, and she said to this guy, "Do you know how much work it was to grow that crate of lettuce? I don't want to ever see you do that with my lettuce again." Well, he never did. This guy was so changed after that experience that suddenly...
Couldn't get him to unload a truck ever again.
he would go very careful. No, he was like her puppy dog from that point on.
Right.
And he would unload the trucks with her, and he so carefully treated everything. He stopped wasting stuff. He stopped ever putting stuff away in a way that was not great for the produce. And all of a sudden, I realized that I want farmers in our back door of our restaurant all the time, because they're the ones that are going to teach the prep cooks and the line cooks how special their stuff is. And that started our very close relationship with local farmers, and it has done nothing but get greater and greater. And it's just wonderful to see the respect that the cooks have for the stuff, because they know how much work it is to grow the stuff. In fact, now we do 3 or 4 times a year during the main growing season, where we will have cooks go out and work on the farms for a day so they get a chance to see that side of things as well. We haven't yet gotten the farmers in to cook in our restaurant. It seems like it's more going one way than the other, but we'll see.
Well,
maybe one day.
Knowing the farmers that I know, they're out there like 14 hours is a medium day. So doing their work and then coming in the restaurant.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But it is sort of the third branch of government of the restaurant. You've got the front of the house, the back of the house, and then you've got the under the house. Because it's not alchemy. You know, you can't weave straw into gold. You have to start with gold.
You have to start with gold.
Yeah, and the farmers have really enabled a lot of the restaurants. Now, sort of spinning off of that, and not to get too political, but there's been a number of chefs who have been pretty vocal about how some chefs, especially here in the Bay Area, use the incredible farm produce as the end all be all, and don't tend to manipulate food quite enough to make it special. And so, like one instance, they were called out for serving a plate of figs as a dessert, and they called BS on that, and took umbrage with the fact that, you know, you have to manipulate food to really call yourself a chef. And I know a lot of your food is pretty straightforward, very simple, but then it also becomes quite complex. And even on MasterChef, you had one dish that had an air component, I think. Mm-hmm. So where do you find yourself sort of in that whole realm of molecular gastronomy versus what you were just talking about, corn could be a meal?
I like it all. And I can see that we can embrace food in all different ways. You know, there's this really interesting thing that happened that I like to point out to people in the history of flavor, that there was a time during the Middle Ages when the sort of seed of all great knowledge in the world, or in the Western world, we'll say, was in Spain. But Spain was not part of Europe at that time. Spain was part of the whole Arab world. It was sort of that far western section of the Arab world, and it kind of went up toward Europe. And then in 1492, all the Arabs were expelled from Spain, and they had to go across the straits into North Africa there, and they gave up the Alhambra, which was the place where that great seat of knowledge was. During the Middle Ages, all of the kings and queens of Europe would send their kids to the Alhambra for finishing school, because that's where the greatest sophistication was. You know, during the Middle Ages, Europe wasn't a really great place to live. But the cuisine of Spain, that Arab Spain, you know, Spain was under Arab domination for 8 centuries, okay? The cuisine was that complex spice cuisine that we all associate with all of North Africa, going over into the Middle East, and certainly all through Southeast Asia. That all comes from sort of the Arab world going two different directions. And they, you know, they were all into alchemy. They thought that that if you could create a new flavor out of simple flavors that you put together, that you had done the greatest thing a cook could ever do. And during the height of the Arab world, especially the Spanish section of the Arab world there, the kings were all great cooks because they were all trying their hand at alchemy. Well, one of the things after the expulsion of the Arabs was to look at that alchemical approach to cooking as a travesty, an awful thing to do. And that what we should really be doing is putting a few herbs, not spices, but herbs into our food. And everything should taste super simple. And you should be able to say, instead of, no, I taste the alchemy that's happening in this dish. No, I taste the simple vegetable with the basil on it. And you know, that change just swept all over Europe. And it was a way of sort of throwing out all of that Arab influence that had sort of crept into the cooking of Europe. And that is the sort of thing that is still prevalent in this country as to what good food is. And that takes me to this whole notion of kind of ethnic cooking. Because when you say ethnic cooking versus non-ethnic cooking, really basically all we're saying is third world food versus first world food. And it happened, just think about Italy, okay? At one point in time, Italy went from being a third world country to being a first world country. And it's probably in most of our lifetimes that we have seen that transformation happen. And Italian food went from being ethnic food to being great food, the stuff that we all want to eat. So there's this whole strong political component that is all tied up in what we eat and what we look at. So to go back to what you said about serving a plate of figs on a plate and or as a dessert, and is that cooking or not? It's sort of the epitome of, we are not going to mess with our food, and we're going to consider that to be the absolute best thing that we can do as cooks. Versus
restraint.
That's total restraint in that. Versus what you find all through the Arab world, which is we have to transform these basic ingredients into something that takes on a completely new life. And if it hasn't taken on a new life, then it's not, we haven't done our job as cooks. The unfortunate thing is that last thing that I said is always associated with ethnic cooking or third world cooking, not with first world cooking. So it's sort of political what you said, but more than that, it's sociological. And I think sometimes we just don't see that. We don't see that our approach to the food is really one of, like, what are our biases in our lives? What are our prejudices in our lives about what food can be good and what food is good? That's very esoteric, I know. So we can.
So, at Tapalabampa, which is your more fine dining establishment, do you encourage your cooks to explore more molecular gastronomic techniques and ways of preparing food? Sort of play with their food a little bit more.
Yes, completely. I'm open to anything. Some things will stick and some things won't stick, but I am a firm believer that all food is in a state of evolution. If it's not, it's a dead cuisine. And so there's that slow food thing that says that only the good food is only the good as the food that has already been made. And I say, no, the good food is the food that we are making today, and it's always going to have lots of influences. Now, if we say that Italian food is and it's talked about mostly with Italian food. If you think about Italian food as being sort of a codified cuisine, when do you codify it? Was it before the tomatoes came or after the tomatoes came? And I always sort of point that out because they say, oh, no, after the, well, wait a second, then why, what happened, why was it okay to bring the tomatoes from the New World and make them a major part of Italian cuisine But it's not, say, okay to bring ginger into Italian cuisine. Well, I say that there's always going to be influences in cuisine. When you look at what is now called classic Mexican food, the regional food of Mexico, it's the biggest example of fusion cuisine you'll ever find in your life. It's got a whole lot of elements from Southeast Asia. It's got a whole lot of elements from Europe. They all sort of collided in Mexico. They were seen through the perspective of the indigenous cuisine of Mexico, and what came out of that is what we now know as sort of Mexican cuisine. And I think that it's really exciting to see things evolve. So I don't consider myself to be the person who is sort of doing museum quality food, like, oh, I tasted this dish in one place, and so I'm going to recreate it exactly for you, because I don't think you can. Food has to be made for people, and it has to be made in a place with ingredients from that place, and so that's what we do in our restaurant. So if I'm not doing museum quality food, I'm a practitioner. I'm not a curator, I'm a practitioner. And I see our cuisine in our restaurant evolving a fair amount, and it has influences because we live in the United States of molecular gastronomy. Some of that stuff is going to stick. Some of it we'll laugh about it in 5 years and we'll say that was the stupidest thing we ever did in our lives. Can you believe we ever did that? But just go back and look at your high school yearbook picture. I mean, you know, it just goes to show you that there's always going to be those crazy things that you did. And it seemed right at that moment, but it might not seem right now.
Right. I want to remind our listeners that you are listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. And our guest today is Chef Rick Bayless, acclaimed chef and restaurateur who is discussing sustainable cuisine and his artful approach to authentic Mexican cooking. Question from the audience. They went to Red O in Los Angeles, and we know you're a big fan of the Bay Area. You've come through here quite a bit. Why did you pick L.A. over us?
I was invited to L.A. I didn't pick it. I'm not the owner of that restaurant. I just manage the kitchens there and all the ingredients and the training and all that sort of stuff. It was kind of interesting to me because I'd done some consulting with people on their kitchens, but I'd never been asked to really take over a kitchen completely, develop it from scratch, hire all the chefs, do all the training for them, and then manage the menu and the development of the menu. We just opened 3.5 months ago, so it's a baby restaurant at the present time. But we decided that we were going to do food like we do it in Frontera, which is our more casual restaurant, not the more inventive Topolobampo. And we would see if people in Los Angeles would go for it, because I lived in Los Angeles before we opened Frontera, so we're talking like 25, 27 years ago I was living in L.A. And I had the opportunity to settle there and open a restaurant there, but I wanted to do the food from Central and Southern Mexico. And everybody that I ran into in L.A. and talked about Mexican food with them, they all said, we know what Mexican food is already. And unfortunately, it did not include anything that I wanted to put on my menu. So I thought it was kind of dangerous for me to actually put a restaurant in L.A. 25 years ago, because I wasn't sure that people were ready to accept it. So here, all these years later, I'm invited to L.A. to do this project. And I think, well, we've come a long way. Certainly people understand that food in Mexico is very different than the American Mexican food, and that there's regional variations in the food of Mexico. And I thought, well, this will be cool. We'll see how it goes. Well, it's been a huge success. And we started off with a menu that wasn't perhaps as ambitious as what we do. I mean, we have 23 years in Frontera and an amazing staff of people that have been cooking it with me for a really long time. So I wanted to start with something simpler that we could make sure we got it right. But it's been a really good success to see that people in LA have really opened their arms to looking at Mexican food in a different way. There are a few other restaurants that are doing Mexican food of a different type in LA, but mostly they're doing very modern versions of Mexican food. And I wanted to do more traditional Mexican food, but traditional Mexican food from regions that they might not know much about. And so that's why I was a little shaky about whether we're going to be successful.
A member of the audience wants to know, Julia Child was reputed to have said that Mexican food was one cuisine she could live without. But we know that you have cooked for her. Were you successful at changing her mind?
Well, let me just put it this way. I never knew she said that until just a couple of years ago, and somebody told me that she had said that. Otherwise, I would have been quaking in my boots when she came in. She was in our restaurant 3 or 4 times, and she really liked it. I was on her TV show when she did one of her last series with Julia Cooks with the Master Chefs, and I cooked food for her that she seemed to absolutely love. Either she was the most gracious person in the entire world, or she liked the food that we did. Maybe she didn't like Americanized Mexican food, but she certainly liked the kind of food that we did, I think. Either that or she was very nice to me.
Well, there's not a lot of call for butter in Mexican food, so that might have been one of the issues. She's like, where do I stick the butter?
Right. Where do you put the butter in this dish?
So we also know, because I think we're all pretty tech savvy here in the Bay Area, that you're a avid Twitterer and blogger. How did the Twittering thing start with you, and why do you tweet so much?
Well, I tell you what, I just think there is such incredible beauty in the world, just amazing beauty. All you have to do is open your eyes to it. It's just everywhere, all around you. And I learned from a photographer friend a long time ago that it's all in the details, that if you look at a big picture of something, then you'll miss this gorgeous little thing that's over here, that you just need to sort of zero in on the beautiful stuff that's around you all the time. Now, I look at a blank computer screen and think I have to do a blog entry and think, oh gosh, it'll take me hours to sort of craft this beautiful piece, that I wasn't posting very much on my blog, and except in the rare occasions when things were like I really had something important that I needed to communicate or that I wanted to weigh in on. And then somebody introduced me to Twitter, and it's 140 characters and the opportunity to put a photo. And all of a sudden I thought, this is really who I am. I'm always pointing at people. Like when I'm with friends in Mexico and I'm taking them through the market, and I'll go, don't miss this thing over here, this beautiful little, or look at the way that they put that pile of strawberries out there, or look at that side of hanging beef and how beautifully it was carved, or something like that. And suddenly I realized that with Twitter, I had the opportunity to show those beautiful details with a caption, and that I could share the beauty I see around me all the time, and it's usually culinary beauty, that I could share that with people. And I got started on Twitter doing that and realized that it was the absolute perfect way for me to express what I'm excited about at any given moment. And so this morning I was over at the Ferry Building, and there were these gorgeous details of stuff that I wanted to take pictures with and post on Twitter so that all the people following me will know that when they come to San Francisco, they have to seek that thing out. And sometimes you could be, as you guys know, you could be overwhelmed by the Ferry Building. It said it's the most unbelievable collection of spectacular stuff.
It's our Disney World.
It is so totally that. And I kept saying to my wife and daughter, I kept saying, be still my beating heart, because I would go from one thing and I'd go, oh, but this is so great. And then this is like, I needed to take some tranquilizers when I left there. So it was so beautiful. I was having a hard time figuring out what I wanted to take pictures of to share with the rest of the world, because it's such a stunning collection of rarefied gems that I could almost not take it in all at one time. And I think probably a lot of people would do that. They would walk through there and just glaze over. So you have to kind of take it apart, and you have to just look for one beautiful thing to look at it at a time, because there's such beauty that's over there. So that's why I use Twitter. It's a great way for me to share some of the beauty that's around me and to say the cool things that people are doing. I use it for that too. So I'll go to a benefit event, you know, and since I have so many people that follow my Twitter postings, it gives me an opportunity to say, people come out and support this thing. And you know, people listen and they go and they support good things in the community. I'm really a lot about community building. And that's what I feel like I've been able to do with the people that follow me on Twitter, is to build a community of people that share a love and commitment for things that relate to food and our relationship to it, and how it enhances community. I said when we opened our restaurant 23 years ago that one of the major things I wanted to do was to create a community in the restaurant and then have our restaurant community be an integral part of the community at large in Chicago. And I think that's one of the reasons that I haven't been interested so much in expanding, because I wanted to, I feel so loved by the community that we have created there in Chicago, and I feel like our staff is so much my family that I want to be with them all the time. And if I had lots of restaurants in lots of different places, it wouldn't give me that opportunity. I mean, we all said as a group that we wanted to take on this project in LA so that our staff, our community staff, could go to LA and try to create some community in LA. And we, the whole staff has sort of taken that on as a special project, not just me separately.
Well, I have a lot of questions from the audience that I want to get in here. So I'm going to
do 140 character responses.
Perfect. We're actually going to take a little different tack since we're radio. I'm going to steal from a very good interviewer that I admire a lot, and that's James Lipton from Inside the Actors Studio. Nice. And I always thought this would be a kind of a fun exercise with you, so we'll have to keep these answers kind of on the brief side.
Yep.
Favorite ingredient?
It would probably be, I don't choose favorites typically, but maybe chipotle chilies in a can, because I can do a whole lot of fast things with them. And so I always have them on the pantry shelf at home, because they can add a little spice, they can add smoke, that you can doctor things up, you can make a glaze with it, you can use it to season a salad dressing, you can do all different kinds of things. So it's probably the most versatile ingredient.
Least favorite ingredient?
Oh, celery.
Boy, that was quick.
Ooh. I don't know why anybody would grow it or use it. I have to say, I have no relationship to that stuff at all. I don't get it. They say it takes more calories to process it through your body than it actually provides you, so it's a great diet food. God, if that was what I had to do.
Peanut butter or blue cheese, obviously.
Oh, God, still.
Or dipped in ranch.
You can't even cover its flavor with enough blue cheese, okay?
Celery board, we apologize. career highlight.
Oh, there's just been so many of them. When I got Humanitarian of the Year award at Beard, because it sprung from my desire to create community, and that I had been doing so many different projects to help create community, give back to community, all that sort of stuff. And it only came from the fact that I had instilled a sense of community in our staff so that they were willing as a unit to go out and be a player in our community and give back. And so when I got that award, it was probably the career highlight.
Career disappointment?
God, I don't think I've, let's see, ever had one. I have had career disappointment.
Or something that you wanted to do, like that one taco truck that you thought would really make it out by the ballpark, and for whatever reason, it just never happened.
Oh, okay.
Something that you wanted to do that you haven't had time to get to or something.
Well, no, I'll say this. So with another couple, my wife and I opened a restaurant, I don't know, 15 years ago or so, called Zinfandel, and I wanted to go back to my barbecue roots because I grew up in the barbecue business, and all of a sudden, I realized after we opened the place that I had moved past barbecue, and my heart wasn't in it in the same way it was in doing this regional Mexican food. And so it was a disappointment in one way for me to see that, because it wasn't what I expected. I expected to go back and just rekindle all of that love and passion I used to have for barbecue, and it wasn't there.
Favorite spot in Mexico?
Oh, I have to say probably Oaxaca. My daughter was born, the year before my daughter was born, we started going to Oaxaca for Christmas, which if you haven't been there, it's just absolutely magical. It's a wonderful place to be. And we've done it every Christmas since then. And we have really close friends in Oaxaca. It just feels like a place, because the indigenous nature of the cuisine there and the variety that you find there, It just speaks so loudly to me. I love it. I love the markets there. I love cooking there. So I'd say probably that's the place. If any place in Mexico, if you ask me that question quick, that's where my mind will go.
Least favorite spot? No, I'm kidding.
God, I was really thinking of one.
Favorite non-Mexican dish? A lot of people in the audience want to know what you eat when you're not eating Mexican food.
Okay, well, I like complex spice cuisine, so I always tend to go toward things that like Southeast Asian food because it's all about the complex spices and everything. And, I grew up eating barbecue, and so it's sort of that whole sort of Southern barbecue with all the sides and stuff like that that go with it. That's super comforting to me, but probably if you just said, what do you want to make for dinner tonight? I would say a Thai curry. Yeah, like a Penang type curry or something like that, a red curry. I like red chilies.
Me too. Favorite station to work in your kitchen?
I'm a line cook. I get too distracted being a prep cook. And for years, I had to do both of those things. And I'd be in the middle of making mole and get distracted with something else. And you can't get distracted when you're making mole. I mean, when we did that state dinner in the White House, I spent 7 hours, glued to the stove because I said, I have to concentrate here. But I'm the guy that goes off and takes pictures of beautiful stuff. Okay, so I couldn't. I'm a line cook. And again, it's because of the game of being a line cook. It's like those tickets start coming out and you have to coordinate all the dishes for a table coming up together. And it's like, where are you? And it's all about team playing and all that sort of stuff. And I love being a line cook. So the hotline, not cooking the meat. I like to be the guy that's sort of funneling everything together, getting the plates set up, putting the vegetable garnishes on the plates and all that.
The tournant or the pass station, I guess that would
be? Yeah, we don't use French in our kitchen, so I don't know what you're talking about.
Mickey Hart, the drummer from the Grateful Dead, he used to have to be taped to his chair sometimes.
That would be me.
His drum seat.
Well, when you're working on a line like that, you can't not be in your spot because you've got all those tickets in front of you.
If you weren't a chef, what do you think you would have been?
I probably be in theater. I started off in there and then sort of got diverted in another direction. But I love theater because it's so spontaneous of a moment, and you created everything. Not like movies or television, but doing live theater. I love live presentation.
So your daughter not going into the restaurant business, but going into live theater is actually probably very good feeling for you, I imagine.
Oh yeah, and they're very closely related to one another, and she's been raised in the business, and so she understands what it means to create a special and unique experience for guests at a table, which is very much about the same thing as theater.
Your XM radio show, mm-hmm. Is that still going?
We just finished the last one. It was a 5-part series on the Martha Stewart Channel.
And did you enjoy that?
I loved it. It was really fun. It was really fun. I got a chance to be sitting in the seat that you're in tonight, and I got to interview people.
And what did you like about that?
I liked having conversations where I was leading people into different things that I was interested in learning about because I love learning. And so it was the great opportunity for me to spend time thinking up the questions and then and drawing things out of people and having a conversation about it.
What was the sense of the difference between the medium of television, which you've done much of and been very successful at, and radio? Because it's a very different medium. Did you find it really comfortable for you to sort of switch a hat?
I loved it, and I loved the fact that it's always more free-flowing, mm-hmm. and you don't have to hit your marks.
Right. And no makeup.
And no makeup, yeah, exactly.
What's next for you? In the media world, can people expect another TV series? Or
yes, we're actually going to do a whole series. We were talking about Baja California. We're going to do a whole series, 13 shows on just Baja California. And it's really amazing. People, we just don't know enough about it. It's really a cool place.
And then finally,
and more books, too.
The
restaurant turns 25. We've never done a restaurant book, so now we're working on a restaurant book. So we'll have a new book out in a couple of years when the restaurant turns 25.
That's interesting. I just realized that you don't have a restaurant book, and that's typically the first book that gets
right.
done by most
restaurants. No, I've been interested in helping people cook at home, and so I've always focused on what to cook at home.
A chef friend of mine who's working on his first cookbook is not doing, he's doing a technique book as well, but said it was like, creating your own high school yearbook, and he wasn't really interested in doing a high school yearbook.
That's kind of why I've shied away from it as well.
Well, I just want to thank you so much for spending your time with us today. It has been a real pleasure to interview you and speak with you, and thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you, Joey.
Our thanks to Rick Bayless, acclaimed chef, winner of Bravo's Top Chef Masters and author of the new book, Fiesta at Rick's, Fabulous Food for Great Times with Friends. We'd also like to thank our audience here and on the radio and the internet. Tonight's program has been part of the Commonwealth Club's Food Lit series, underwritten by the Bernard Osher Foundation. I'm Chef Joey Altman, and now, this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned.